Welcome to our talk about the front-end workspace. My name is Michael Riemann, and this is Alexander Holtkamp.
Hi.
And we're going to talk about three topics today. The first one is we want to show you the new features in CMS 9 since the 18.04 release. And we're going to talk about the new features we're going to put into the next major release, the Comedia Content Cloud. And I guess we have enough time, and I want to talk about some best practices to do front-end with Comedia. So let's start with what's new in CMS 9. So we choose 18.04 because that was the last developer conference. And I guess most of you have been there. So the features we presented in that time should be familiar to you. So let's start with our developing tool, Yarn Start. Who of you is using this command to develop front end already? OK, thank you. So by default, our Yarn Start command is working with a remote CIE. But sometimes, if you want to change blueprint stuff in the CIE, like content beans and that, then you have to switch the yarn start command to work with the local CIE. And you right now, you have to do it in the front-end config files. And I always have to remember what I have to enter in the config file. And I always forgot it. So what we changed in 18.07, we added just a shortcut to the yarn start. Just use yarn start minus dash dash local to start the developing workflow in a local mode. And if you have changed your config file to a local mode by default, you can switch to remote by just adding dash dash remote. So yarn start is how to import a development copy to your user home folder and to work with Studio and with your CIE. And sometimes you want to show your changes to colleagues, or you think it's ready to show it or to deploy it to all the other customers or editors on the same system. So we added, since 18.07, a new command called yarn deploy. And this is will create a production copy of your theme, and it will import it to the official themes folder. So it's very easy to develop your theme, add changes, and then deploy it to the machine to show it to all the others. And it's very handy to install new themes. So the other thing we changed in 18.10, that we enhanced our search brick. So we enhanced the brick and some backend. So it's now possible to expand, to add expandable filter facets, like taxonomies, to the search. Also, we added a sort by date button to the search field. And the most important thing is that we added a load more button to the results. So it's very easy to load more results on a, like in a way of a single page application. We also added a very simple pagination, like shown in on the slide. So it's very simple, and it's just configurable via content settings, like we do it with a lot of other things. So this is an example, like we do it with in the Callisto theme. On the top right, you see the sort by button. And by default, it's still relevance, but you can change the date. On the left, you see the new search facets, like category. You can add tags or types and whatever you want to do. And below the results, you will see the load more button, which will instantly load some more results. So the next topics are more technically so, and I will hand over to Alex.
Yeah, as Michael said, I'm talking about some more build-related topics. Let's start with view repositories. What we see here is a theme which has two dependencies, on brick 1 and brick 2. Then there's a build process, and the build process will transform these themes into multiple target folders. Some target folders contain CSS, some JS, and so on, but there will also be target folders for the view repositories. So what you have here is you get a view repository for the theme and a view repository for all used bricks of the theme. So that's basically OK. Let's see the next example. Now you have two themes. The first theme is the same theme as before, while the second theme only uses brick 2 and brick 3. Now we have the build process. Theme 2 will get an own view repository, while theme 1 shares the same bricks view repository with the first theme. That's not problematic as long as the builds are done one after each other, but as soon as they would be built in parallel, you would get into problems because the bricks folder is shared. Yeah, basically, it contains the used bricks of the last build theme. As I said, it is not problematic when importing the theme, but if you work with the local development workflow, there is a problem because you can only develop on the last, build theme. That's why we changed it since 1810. We now have only a single view repository that's made for the theme and also contains the used bricks. And in that case, you have no problems. And you can especially build multiple themes at once. That is already enabled in our newer versions. And it will speed up the build of multiple themes by quite a large amount. The next topic is scaling the front-end workspace. What you see here in the picture is the classical structure of our front-end workspace. The top-level folder is the workspace folder, while you have a lot of child folders, one for the remote packages, which is the node modules folder, one for Comedia-specific packages, and then most probably the folder of your interest, where you can put your bricks and your themes into. As soon as the theme is built, you will get a target folder where the build theme is stored. But what if you just want to have a single theme, have no additional bricks, and are not interested in a large scaling workspace? Well, this is now possible. You can have the theme as a top-level folder, and then have all the dependencies delivered via the remote packages folder in the node modules. And the theme will then have its own target folder where its production build is stored. What you can also do is you can remove our own packages and let them provide via the remote packages folder. And then you would have a structure where you can develop multiple themes and your bricks. And these bricks are shared among themes. Well, you might ask how this is possible. Well, we are using NPM, and basically it's similar to Maven. You can put every NPM package into an NPM registry. And this registry can be accessed to retrieve remote packages. So everything that is not in the workspace can be retrieved there. And so you don't need to maintain, especially in versioning, a local copy of these packages. The next topic is about sharing common template functionality. Let's start with our FreeMaker facades. We have a lot of FreeMaker facades, as you see here. On the left side, there are the Java classes. And then we have a dedicated FreeMaker file, which contains access to these Java functionality in a FreeMaker way via macros and functions. And on the right side, you see the global variable under which these functions are accessible. The initial purpose of these FreeMaker facades was to provide access to backend functionality that is not provided via content beans. So for example, this includes link building or view dispatching, settings and localization lookup, and special calculations like for responsive images and image map hot zones. During the years, however, it was enriched with much more. We added FreeMaker helper function, we added conditional rendering, component rendering for buttons, containers, and the outer skeleton of the image map, and for example, grid handling for Bootstrap. The drawback of the whole thing was that the FreeMaker facades became quite big, and they are on the back-end side, not in the front-end workspace. So, well, you could ask the question, why do we put them here? It's basically a problem that you receive skeletons, but you don't have any styling or JavaScripts that are related to that, and these things are only brought via the workspace. Furthermore, the initial purpose was to provide backend functionality, but they don't need any backend in order to work at all. That's why we decided to split the whole thing up. We now where the FreeMaker facades again serves their initial purpose by providing backend functionality, and the FreeMaker libraries will contain special rendering code. Let's see an example of that. Here we have a FreeMaker file, and there's an import statement with the file path, and this file is made accessible under a variable named slickCarousel. After the import, the functionality can be used by using add slickCarousel.render and then passing the parameters. The import itself, or the path of the import itself, can be split up into three major information. One information that I already marked is the package the FreeMaker library comes from. In that case, it's a Comedia slickCarousel package. Then we have a relative path inside the package, which in that case is the source FreeMaker libs slickCarousel.ftl, and a magical first part, which is an asterisk with slash node modules. This has been made to imitate the function that Node.js does to look up its packages. Basically, this means look in the parent hierarchy until you find a matching pattern to these paths behind the asterisk pattern. So this is exactly what Node.js does. And so we could use or combine these two worlds, the FreeMaker world, which is basically Java, with the lookup of the node modules. And IDEs like IntelliJ provide full code support for that. What we will do in the scene build is we will transform these paths into different paths, as we're packing it into jar files to upload it to the content server, and there won't be any node modules for the different. The benefits of that is that we now have a clearer separation of concerns. The template code is where the styling and JavaScript code is, and that's new, the remote developer workflow can be used. With the backend FreeMaker facades, you can't make any changes using the remote developer workflow. Code assist was already mentioned, and we have now the possibility of offering functionality inside bricks without providing a view which pollutes your view dispatching layer. With a stable API that is based on the language FreeMaker we are using. Much more important, these libraries are much more performant than a CM include, as a CM include requires building a request context on each include. Now we come to the new features in Comedia Content Cloud. First of all, we updated many of our third-party dependencies. Worth mentioning are the upgrades to Webpack and Babel. Webpack is now in version 4, and Babel is in version 7. While this, of course, provides a lot of security and stability fixes, we decided that we needed to upgrade these third-party dependencies because most new plugins and the updates for existing plugins are only provided for the new versions. So basically, we had no choice. Especially for Webpack, there are some built-in optimizations for development and production builds. we could now make use of. Furthermore, it has improved code splitting capabilities. Code splitting means that you can split up the code into multiple files, for example, to reuse the code for other bundles or to split it up for having smaller file sizes so they can be downloaded parallel. Webpack also states there is a reduced build time, but we didn't think that had much impact. Upgrading Babel 7 was a consequence of upgrading to Webpack 4. Basically, what we could make use of was the JavaScript-based configuration. Before the change, it was only possible to provide configuration with JSON files. So it was quite static configuration, while now we can generate configuration from JavaScript. In addition to this, there is a much smoother ECMAScript 6 module support in conjunction with Webpack. Before the upgrade, we needed to apply a lot of fixes to allow what we have now. And by upgrading these plugins, these fixes could all be removed. Now we talk about the theme descriptor. The theme descriptor is something that is used by the theme importer to create a CM theme document and link the target folder or the imported content of your target folder together. What we see on the left is the theme descriptor. On the right, you see the source folder. And I put a question mark here because all the relative paths inside the theme descriptor do not really map to the source folder. What you need to know is that the theme descriptor always maps to the target folder. Every relative path is based there. So you basically need to whitebox our whole build process. You need to know which sources transform into which target files, which is especially strange for SCSS files, as you have SCSS files in your source folder and they transform into CSS files in the target folder. Here's a small overview. We have a source folder, then Webpack builds the source folder into a target folder, and the theme descriptor is not included here. It is just copied over and then utilized by the theme descriptor. Besides the fact that you need to know how the sources will be transferred, you also get no feedback if a path you added in the theme descriptor is wrong, as it is not passed or similar by our theme build process. You also didn't get an information here on how to add additional CSS or JavaScript files, as you are relying on the fact that everything is there, and then you can make something with it. What if we could just use references in the source folder of the theme? And that's the actual change. We are introducing a theme configuration. So I adjusted the last slide. Now the theme configuration configures Webpack. And Webpack will transform the theme configuration into the theme descriptor. Everything else stays as it is, but now you can influence how the build process works and add additional files. And worth mentioning is that it's also no longer XML. In the front-end workspace, we are working a lot with CSS, JavaScript, and JSON, and it feels or felt strange that we needed an XML configuration. It has now changed to JSON. Here you see a small overview. This is basically the old theme descriptor written in the new theme configuration. Let's go into more detail. First of all, we have the metadata containing the name description and the thumbnail image to be presented inside the studio. While the name and description have stayed the same, the thumbnail is now relative to the source folder. So you no longer need to put it into your public path or similar. You can just put it on top level together with the theme configuration. The next parts are the actual code parts containing of JavaScript and style sheets. First of all, we have a list, and the list contains an item. And this item specifies the actual JavaScript file to be linked on the left side. On the right side, we see that we now tell the build process that a JavaScript file in our source folder should be included. And by specifying the type, we can tell the build process that it should be bundled with Webpack. Two other types are the copy. This will just copy over the JavaScript file, and external link, which will create an external link in the resulting rendering. The same applies to the style sheets. You can also pass additional configuration in the configuration for the corresponding script or style. For example, in that case, the in-head property. You might wonder why disable compress is missing. We already stated that we will be removing the server-side compression in favor of Webpack, because Webpack already does that. And the YUI compressor hasn't been updated for quite some years now, so it doesn't cope with any newer JavaScript language features. The next part are the template sets. As mentioned in the slides before, we only have one view repository now. So that one is just a thing we can generate. You no longer need to specify that. The last part are the resource bundles. The old state contained the relative link inside the targets folder, while the new state will only contain the bundle names without any folders or the suffix for language or properties files. We can't change the fact that these are properties files, so it's not a configuration that contains any information for us. The language has been consolidated by introducing a master language property, which defaults to English. So in that case, it is not defined, as the defaults are already applied. More advantages are that we can now add dynamically generated files to the build. As mentioned before, Webpack has improved its code splitting capabilities. So we can, out of the box, include a way to split large JavaScript chunks up into smaller files. So this improves performance. What we can also do now is validation of the system configuration. So you have a way to fail early in case of problems. Another addition to the build process are settings. Many brick templates will rely on settings which are provided in the test content. For example, preview settings, Elasticsocial settings, or teaser rendering. We are in the progress of identifying clearly theme-specific settings that can be provided by the front-end workspace. One candidate we have clearly defined is the preview configuration, as this is, in our view, clearly theme-specific. You need to know device settings, so you need to know which breakpoints the theme will define and when other devices are translated over, or when there's a translation to another device. And also the view names are specific to a theme. In addition to that, a theme can also provide specific CSS and JavaScript files for the preview. For example, to remove a parallax effect, which is not needed when previewing items. Well, you might question, how does this work? We are providing a functionality which will allow to put JSON files into a theme and also into bricks. These JSON files are aggregated by the theme build and will then be imported via the theme importer, which will translate them into CM settings documents. The settings lookup will then take these settings into account as a last resort. So the hierarchy would be you have the concrete content where settings can be, you have a page, and if no setting is defined here, it will fall back to the theme. This also means that the old mechanism is still in place. You don't need to migrate anything, it will just be a fallback. We also introduced an improvement in sharing functionality via packages. Let's have another example. We have a seam, and it has three dependencies, two big one, two, and three. Now we have another seam. It has the same dependencies. And as working evolved, you see that it's basically the same seam, but it has different colors. What you could in the older versions was to introduce a common brick, which encapsulated all the common stuff, and then have a dependency to the common brick from the seams you want to share the code with. What we can do now is we have a parent seam. This parent seam will aggregate the bricks, and then a child seam can depend on the parent seam. Now you might ask, what's the difference between that besides of the color? Well, the first thing is a brick, so it is not built itself. Well, the second thing is a seam, so it's a deliverable, which will be imported in the content. Furthermore, a seam can contain Webpack configuration, which you might need. So you are able to share Webpack configurations between seams now. As a rule of thumb, you can decide for yourself which one you prefer, is that we see a common brick as an isolated feature, while a parent seam can be used as a standalone seam. Let's talk about bricks again. I made a wall which contains all of our bricks we are currently maintaining. These bricks are supposed to fulfill a lot of aspects. They should provide large prefabrication, they should work out of the box, they should be highly customizable, they should be able to survive version upgrades by providing a stable API. They should reflect our best practices, and they should, of course, be easy to understand for you to reuse. These are quite conflicting aspects. If the brick is highly customizable, it is difficult to understand because there are many, many options. If we extend customization because of stability and to not have a breaking change, the API becomes larger, and so it is more difficult to understand. Overwriting prefabrication can be a pain, especially in CSS, with breakpoints for different devices that you need to overwrite if you want to have something different. Furthermore, if the brick provides prefabrication, which works out of the box, it will have an impact on stability of the API, because if you migrate to a newer version of the front-end workspace, these features will be enabled out of the box, which you might not want. We tried hard, but we cannot handle all the different aspects in one layer. That's why we decided to give bricks a clear purpose. Either it is an API brick or an example brick. API bricks are supposed to focus on being customizable and stable, but they don't necessarily need to be working out of the box or need to be super easy to understand. They are APIs, so they are quite complex. In contrast to that, there are example bricks, which should provide the other aspects, as prefabrication, working out of the box, and they should also be a good example, as the name says, for you to start your front end and to customize it. These example bricks are meant to be copied. They should not be taken as a direct dependency. So you can improve them and have a snapshot of these seams, and you are not affected by any future upgrades on that case. Now I'll be handing over to Michael.
Yeah. Thank you, Alexander. So with all the new features, we want to use them for ourselves too, of course. So we're going to introduce in Comedia Content Cloud a new theme called Shared Example Theme. And like you see in the name, this will be the shared theme for parent theme for all our future Comedia themes. In Comedia 9, we already have the Callisto theme, and this will be a child theme of the shared example theme. We're going to introduce a new theme called Chef Corp for well, more for a corporate website. And this shared example theme includes a lot of default styles and enables some common bricks we want to use, define some grids, and we're going to use our new example bricks for some banner types. So we're going to introduce a hero banner, a portrait banner, and a landscape banner. So these are some layout variants, and we want to use them, but they are not like an API brick, so they're going to be our example bricks. So the new ChefCorp theme, like I said, will be a shell theme of the shared example. And we're going to remove the corporate theme, so because it's now like 3 or 4 years old and it doesn't fit really into our new concept. So, and the good part is if we're going to do the more things in the shared example theme, the ChefCorp theme just add like, I think, 3 templates and a few stylings to change what should be different to the shared theme. And that's it. And it's very easy to just enable some more bricks. So, our ChefCorp theme will include the download portal for the asset management. And we just add the dependency, and that's fine. So this is a first look of how our ChefCorp theme will look like. As you can see, there will be some new layout variants. So there will be a hero, a landscape banner, a portrait banner. We're going to introduce some responsive carousel for products. So like typical front-end layout variants you want to use in on a website. So now let's switch to the best practices in front-end. I have 3 topics to want to talk about. So the first one is about themes. So it was very painful in the past to create a new theme. So mostly you took already a Comedia theme and use it as a starting point. So we recommend to use our CLE tool. So it's very easy to use. It's just yarn create theme, add your name, how the theme should look like. And this tool will ask you for the theme inheritance if you want to inherit from any theme. Ask you for all available bricks you want to use in the theme. And then it will create all necessary configs and folders. And this will already include the new theme descriptor Alex was talking about. So all this JSON configuration, you don't have to do it if you're using this tool. You get it out of the box. So with this, it's very important that you see our Comedia themes for the ChefCorp or Callista more like examples how you could create your websites. So of course, they can change between the AEP releases. So sometimes you still want to use them as a starting point. So we recommend that you should fork it. Like, then you have a snapshot that is going to be stable, and you don't have problems when you're updating to new versions. So here's a very simple quick start if you want to start with a front-end workspace. So first thing, you're going to create your new theme with yarn create theme. Then you're going to switch to the theme. Then you can call our new tool yarn deploy. Then you will get a copy of your theme, even if it's empty. But all the structure, all the stuff is included to the content server. And then you can go to the studio, and you can select the new theme directly onto the site you want to change. And then you go back to your workspace and start developing with Yarn Start. So that should be very easy. The next topic is, after developing, of course, deployment. We get a lot of questions. So now we have the new Yarn Deploy. But this should be only be used to push themes to a test environment. So if you're working with other people to show your changes and other editors. So, but if you want to publish a theme on a live system, that should be in a different way. So our recommendation is, of course, using automation. And we included in our front-end manual a new chapter about that. So thanks to Felix, he wrote that. With a lot of example configuration for Jenkins, how you can publish a theme with Git and Jenkins and CM import themes and bulk publish, that you always get a released version of your theme to a live system. So the last topic I want to talk about is FreeMarker. So FreeMarker has some problem because it can't handle null. But the good thing is it has some built-in checks. So our recommendation is always use the question mark has content check. And please, you should or try to use this has content check and not the question mark check, because the difference is that the has content not only will check for missing values, and it will also check for empty values. So this can be very helpful. Another very important thing is if you receive data from its backend, sometimes you don't know if it's empty or if it's null or whatever. So if you retrieve data from the backend or from somewhere else, try to add exclamation mark to add a default. And sometimes you have the problem that you really have a null object and not only a string or a hash map. That's why we introduce a cm.undefined function. So this will always return an empty object to avoid exceptions. So I have here some examples. So I think the first one should be very easy. So you get from some self object as a title, and if it's empty, you add a default an empty string. And then you can use has content in the rest of your template. If you have empty lists, you have to use square brackets, and for hash maps, the third example. And the last one is like if you include an item and if you're not sure if it could be null, just add cm undefined, and this cm include will never fail. But one more last example, what about this? So we have some object and the property of this object, and we add a default handler. So looks like should be safe. But it isn't. It still can cause a null pointer exception, because some object can be null. So how to handle this? And for this, FreeMarker added just regular brackets. You should put it around the whole call, and then the default will be empty string. So this could help you to avoiding null pointer exception. And if you're not sure, you can always add some brackets, and you're safe. So yeah, that's some best practices from us. We really want to hear some feedback of you. Meet us at the roundtables at 4, and let us know what you are missing, what you want to see in the front-end workspace. Well, thank you.